Well, while we are keeping in the focus with earnings, Lupin as well announced their earnings. Rakesh Jhunjhunwala, as always, at his best, quizzed the management in their con call about the road ahead for the company. So hear out what his questions were and what the management has to say. We can get a sense of what we can expect from the counter in the near to medium term.
My question is, Vinita, when you say that on one side, Sandoz and Teva are closing down some products, or withdrawing some products and increasing size of certain products.
Yeah.
So, what does it mean? Is it, I mean, are you saying that the process of the bottoming out of pricing has started, but the actual prices are still declining?
We think that it's really starting to bottom out when you start seeing large players like Teva and Sandoz getting out of a large portfolio of products. It's really sent a signal that they are at the pain point, you know, from our perspective. The number of product discontinuations that we have seen in the last 6 months has been more than what I've seen in the last couple of years. Again, to me, that's a signal that companies have got to their pain point. You know, when I sit down with a number of our peers, both here as well as in the U.S., then what I'm hearing from companies, other CEOs, is that all of them have been challenged over the last couple of years, and believe that for us to be able to maintain a healthy generic market, we have to be able to get a reasonable return on our the products that we supply. So all of those suggest to me that we are starting to see a bottoming out. We've seen a few products where we have been able to pick up volume at a margin higher than what we have seen in the past. But I wish I could say that for 30-40% of our portfolio. But I would hope that within this year we start to see the bottom. I think we are close to it.
Right. So therefore, as of now, you're still seeing erosion, but the erosion in number of products is coming down.
Yes.
Second thing, Ramesh mentioned that you're rejigging your portfolio, the R&D towards the new reality of the American market. So what are you doing? You are reducing number of products in which even competition will be huge, or products which are not complex enough?
Yes, Rakeshji. It's basically optimizing our pipeline. When we look at the changes that have taken place in the U.S. market, which are structural, we have these three major players that demand their pound of flesh. When you look at product launches where you are one of five, one of six, the kind of return one can afford to make is not certain. So when we look at a pipeline with that lens and prioritize it, we have the potential of pruning a pipeline down to products where we can be one of three, four, and have certainty on both the return as well as sustainable margin revenue potential. And that's what we're doing, not losing any material opportunities, but looking at the pipeline with the current, with the changed market dynamics to determine what makes, what investments we should definitely make and what we can do without.
That would be a very difficult task, because you are saying the market is going to undertake a change. A lot of people are going to estimate. The estimate today that with products how many people will come would be a very challenging task, isn't it?
I think you go after complexity. I think that defines how many people will eventually make it. I think we'll still end up doing 15, 20 oral solid products. We'll do probably 8 to 10 injectable products a year. And we will do, at least a couple of inhalation products. We will one biosimilar every year as well. So I think it's obviously going to be a meaningful number of projects, but the idea is to focus on that select list and make sure that the 15, 20 that you want are the ones that we deliver.
And when do you expect approval of your injectable plant, your new plant?
I'm sorry, what is the question?
When will the injectables come?
Yeah, so we filed four last quarter. So in the next financial year, we hope to actually launch a couple of them because the FDA is actually very quick in the review process. And our injectable plant is ready. So I think in the next month or two, we'll start taking exhibit batches from there.
Next year, you'll have products from the injectables.
Yes. So
that's correct.
And you'll have some complex products also in the injectables?
Yes, so I think we are focusing on the, I would say, medium range of complexity at this point. The more complex products will come out of Nanomi, which will get filed from FY20.
Okay, thank you.
Right, that's of course RG at his best, grilling the management of Lupin, trying to understand what lies ahead for the company. We will try and get a sense of what this means if you're an investor or, you know, you're looking at buying a stock like Lupin. Cipla and Aurobindo also report earnings later on in the day. We'll be touching base with the pharma analyst right after this break to get some perspective into what they're making of Lupin's numbers and what your expectations are from Cipla and Aurobindo. So stay tuned.